That nicely segues into Miramare, because one of the things that really impressed me about that track is obviously it starts with a kind of choral arrangement almost, but you know, you've got at various times on the album, you've got Alberto singing or sharing the lead vocals with Oscar, who comes in, and, and we haven't really heard Oscar sing like that before. And then, you know, a little bit later on in the same song, you get NDV joining them, and the three of them are kind of harmonizing in almost like Crosby, Stills and Nash kind of way. And that feels like it is a bit different for Big Train to now suddenly have this vocal canvas with so many really good singers who, you know, it's not as perhaps in the past it was David and Nick, a little bit of supporting stuff. This feels a lot more like an ensemble thing.
Yeah, I agree. I think Alberto's very happy for others to, you know, I mean, we're a slightly unusual band in as much as we've got a number of really good singers. So that at any time, you know, they could break things down and enter into a lovely vocal round. And we started to do that live a fair bit, but I think it was what was great with me with Alberto. I think some, put it this way, some lead singers are like, oh, no, this is my domain. You know, you're not, get your lips away from those microphones. This is what I do. But Alberto's not like that. You know, he understands that each and every one of the singers, Claire, Ricard, Oscar or NDV, they bring their own unique vocal style, and therefore it's great to get them heard in different ways or in different places, just as a solo voice. So the arrangements were very carefully worked out so that people could have some lead vocal moments, and I think that's something we'll definitely be doing more of in the way forward. We have so much strength and depth in that department. It makes perfect sense to deploy those voices.
Yeah, actually, it was Beneath the Mask, isn't it? I was getting confused between Miramare and Beneath the Mask with Oscar and Alberto, and then the three of them singing together. But on Miramare, it does have that kind of.
Well, Rick, I think Ricard takes a couple of lead Miramare. So it's, yeah, I mean, there's a few examples of this across the album where individuals come in and then voices sort of join in. So you're not wrong to pick out that song as an example of the different vocal stylings coming through, and they love it. You know, they all want to sing, and so yeah, I think, you know, as we learn more. I mean, this album, you know, we knew a fair bit about each other, but I mean, so obviously the old guys in the band, we've known each other a long time, but you know, for the new talents, for the new band members, it was a learning curve as well as everything else. So, you know, we spent that week together in Trieste and we've been on tour now, and you know, we know what everyone can bring to the table. And so I think that will inform us in the next album that we make.
And Miramare is the song that is, I guess, the most traditionally, it's a big Train historical epic, isn't it? Although it's kind of the one that has a lot of connection with Trieste itself, because it's about Maximilian and Charlotte. Although it was kind of interesting, because there's a line in the song that's talking about, you know, she was looking for one last summer, all their dreams running over the edge. It's still got that whole sense of, you know, looking forwards, trying to make the most of the time you've got, because you're not quite, you know, you can't really be certain what's going to happen tomorrow. And obviously in their case, it wasn't, it's not a happy tale, that one, is it, really, from a,
oh God,
as
no,
the subject matter, it's sad.
It is very sad. And, you know, they're a big local story in Trieste, but they're not really very well known many other places around the world. And in fact, originally, so Albie had written the backing track, and he'd said, you know, can you deliver some words for it? And, you know, and I thought, I want to write one of our history songs, but based in Italy. And originally I found the story in Rome that I quite liked. But that had, when I began to do more reading about it, this guy which was slightly connected to Brave Captain, really. It's a guy from the First World War, and he became a bit of a war hero, and real interesting character. But then he'd been adopted. I found, as I did some reading, I found out he'd been adopted by the fascist movement in the 30s as being a sort of an exemplar of, you know, masculinity or whatever. And I thought, okay, I ain't going anywhere near that.
Right. Yeah.
Not for a moment. So that, that kind of, you know, hopes dashed because I'd done a fair bit of reading on it. So then Albie said, well, how about the Maximilian and Carlotta? And so I five books on the Habsburgs later, I found myself quite deeply immersed in this world. I don't, you know, I'm a kind of Roman Anglo-Saxon history kind of nut, so I don't really know much about later history. So it took quite a lot of reading for me. And one of the decisions I had to make was because a lot of their story is set in Mexico, because it was a kind of last gasp of empire kind of thing.
Yeah.
Where they were sent off to be the emperor and empress of Mexico. But I didn't want it to be about Mexico. I wanted it to be a story in Trieste. So Miramare, the castle that which they built as their home, became the title, and you know, it ends with her effectively returning there after Maximilian has been faced the firing squad and going quite mad.
Yeah.
Probably suffering from schizophrenia, I would say. So almost haunting this castle, and there is a folklore sort of ghost story element to the story now as well, with, you know, some suggestions that she still haunts the place. So I kind of, that was a little bit of imagination that I put in there too. But it's an extraordinary story, and I just like the fact that it was that sort of last gasp of the kind of European empires, you know, before the First World War, of course. Which really was one of the last gasps of these sort of things, you know. But the Mexicans weren't having it, you know. So it felt like the tides of history, all that sort of stuff, was in there. So there's a big story, but there was, as you say, there was a really personal story at the bottom of it. It was a love affair between two people whose home was in Trieste, and so that, in a funny way, also connected me to Love Is the Light. You know, I began to feel the songs were, you know, in a very slight way connected, because Love is a contemporary love story, but obviously based about two people from Trieste.
Yeah, and I think having read up more about the background to the song, I mean, I love that kind of opening, because it is kind of very stately and very measured, you know, in its with the vocal harmonies. It kind of feels, it's got the gravitas for this,
yeah,
you know, this doomed aristocratic
It's a beautiful start, and actually that was a later addition, that start. I just goes to show, I said to you before, that the songwriting process is a messy business. It's not you know, it's not a linear business at all. So originally the song start, and in fact I think the single version will do this. I think we lose the top of the song for the single version, because it's obviously very long to be a single. So it originally just started, you know, straight where the drums and the bass come in. And Albie came up with this kind of 2-minute sort of prelude,
right,
which connected directly to that quite late on, actually. So yeah, we were writing up against the wire, really, in terms of, you know, getting things to, you know, as I said to you earlier, the word you sculpted, it, that was, you know, we were trying to extract the most from every song, you know, trying to make the arrangements as good as we could get them, trying to, you know, I think this is a, we can't afford to blunder our way into an album. You know, this has got to be us at the top of our musical right. game. And that's why, you know, Albie was kind of rewriting right up until as late as he could, really, to get that as he wanted it to be.
And in that second half of Miramare, I think if you're thinking about how it will come across live, it seemed to have a lot of there's some real tour de force drumming by Nick in the second half of that song, which I think will really, when you play it live, will really leap out of the
because, you know, that's the thing with this, with all, and we found you know, you find, I mean, I sent you that live recording of Boy in Darkness, and, you know, it's interesting listening to something that in the studio was quite, was very carefully crafted, but live you can really just sort of feel your way through. And there's a bit near the end of that, of A Boy in Darkness Live, where Andy V just slows everything down. And so we're all having to watch him because he's just pulling the beat back so incredibly much so that you land on that last chorus. And that's the beauty of live performance, when you really understand a song. And I think when we get, there's that big bit in the middle with their sort of trons and drumming going mad and all those sort of things. So I think this would be quite a fun one for us to play live next year. The tide, far away from the-